This is lesson 5.4, day 2. We're going to continue our study of factoring by looking at different types of factoring today. If you have not watched the day 1 video or participated in an in-class lesson on this material, then I strongly encourage you to go back and watch the day 1 video to learn the basics of factoring, because the skills that you learned in day 1 are needed for day 2. In today's lesson, we're going to be focusing on problems where the lead coefficient is not 1. So instead of having the x squared plus or minus bx plus or minus c, we're going to have problems that look more like this. Ax squared plus bx plus c. And then the signs will vary depending on the problem. But in a generic form, the lead coefficient, the coefficient on the variable that has the highest exponent, has a value that is non-1, but also is not a GCF that we can remove, as we did in the previous lesson. We're also going to talk about how to factor by grouping. We'll look at this problem at the end of the lesson. So when you are factoring these types of problems where the lead coefficient is not 1, then we're going to have to pay attention to the factor pairs of both the lead coefficient and the constant. And then we're going to have to figure out what combination can we use, one factor pair from A and one factor pair from the constant C, in order to create that BX in the middle. There are different approaches to solving these types of problems. The way that I teach it to my students is that it's a more mental math and in your head process, where other teachers may teach more systematic ways using boxes with squares in them or different approaches in order to factor. Use whatever method works best for you. So we're going to list the factor pairs for the constant and the quadratic coefficient. And then we're trialing and erroring. We're testing the different pairs to figure out what works, and I'll show you what that looks like right now. So here we have a trinomial where the lead coefficient is not 1, and there is no GCF. There is not a common factor that I could divide away from all three of those terms. So the first thing I want to do is I want to list the factors of 2 and the factors of 9. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to basically pair them up. I'm going to say, okay, well, clearly the only option for 2 is 2 and 1, since 2 is a prime number. So I know that my factor pairs have to be 2x and x for those first terms. The only way I can get 2x squared is if I multiply 2x times x. Now I need to figure out, does the 2 and the 1 go with the 9 and the 1 or the 3 and the 3? So my goal is to create a 7. Now remember what's happening here. I'm going to multiply 2x times this number, and I'm going to multiply x times this number to get the O and the I pieces in FOIL. And so I'm going to say, okay, if I multiply 2 times 9, that gives me 18. And if I multiply 1 times 1, I get 1. Now the reason why I'm doing that is because that's what's going to go in these two spots. 9 and 1, or 3 and 3, are going to go in these two spots in my binomials. So when I multiply 2 times 9 and 1 times 1, I get 18 and 1. Can I create a 7 through adding and subtracting? No. That doesn't work. So that means that's not how those numbers are paired up. Well, what if I do 1 times 9 and 2 times 1? Well, 2 times 1 is 2, and 1 times 9 is 9. Can I create a 7 with a 2 and a 9? Yes. You can do 9 minus 2 and get 7. So I found the factor pairs that work. And we'll see that when I substitute them in. So here's where you have to be really careful. Because I put the 2 first and then the 1x second, that dictates where the 9 and the 1 go. So unlike some of the problems we did yesterday where I said it really didn't matter where the constants went in the binomials, which one it went into, it very much matters here where I put the 9 and the 1. So look at my multiplication. What did I do? I did 1 times 9 So here's the 1 from the 2 times 1 times 9. So the 9 needs to go here, and the 1 needs to go here. Now I'm going to have 9x and 2x for my o and my i. And I need to get positive 7x. So what do my signs need to be in order to have a positive 7x? Well, the 9 has to be positive, and the 2 needs to be negative. So go back to my original work here. So the 9x needs to be positive. So when I multiply 9 times x, if this is positive, then I'll get 9x, since the x is also positive. Then if I take 2x times 1, the only way I can make that be negative 2x is to put a minus there. If you look, they're both linear binomials, and so I know that now my answer is completely factored. If I would check it, 2x times x is 2x squared. 2x times minus 1 is minus 2x. 9 times x is 9x. And then 9 times minus 1 is minus 9. Combine my like terms, and you can see that what I have here matches my original trinomial. So this product right here does equal the trinomial that I was originally given. Trial and error really does take practice. It will be something that as you do more examples, as you practice more, that you will get quicker at it. So let's look at another one. If you look at my three terms, you'll notice that there is no GCF between the terms. So I need to look at the factors of 14 and the factors of 5. So 14 times 1 and 7 times 2, and then you have 5 and 1 for the constant term. Now, like the last one, there's only one option. So I know it has to be 5 times 1 in order to get the positive 5. So now I need to work with, okay, 5 and 1 matches up with which one of these factor pairs in order to get 17. Well, certain things are obviously not right. 5 times 14 is going to be a big number, and 1 times 1 is 1. And so there's no way I'm going to have a big number and add and subtract 1 and get 17. So I know that that doesn't work. And if I multiply 14 times 1 and 5 times 1, I'm going to get 14 and 5, and I can't make 17 with that either. So I know that 14 and 1 is just out. It doesn't work, and I can see that very quickly. So now I have to fiddle around with the 2 and the 7. So if I do 2 times 7, that's 35, and I'm like, ooh, that's pretty big. That might not work. 2 times 1 is 2. Can I add or subtract 35 and 2 and get 17? No, you can't. So that doesn't work either. So my last option then is to do 5 times 2 and 1 times 7. And so then I get 10 and 7. And can I get minus 17 with that? Yes, I can, if both of my signs are negative. So when I go to put my information in, it does matter where I put things. So the 2 got multiplied by the 5. So in order for that to happen, that would be my inner term here. So this has to be my 2x, and this has to be my 7x. And then we already determined down below that both the signs need to be negative in order to have negative 17. Notice that if I check my L and FOIL, a negative 5 times a negative 1 is a positive 5. So that's good. And then I have 7x times 2x does give me 14x squared. And then when I check my O and my I, I get negative 10x and negative 7x. And when I add those together, I do get negative 17x, which is what I wanted. Both of these binomials are linear binomials, so I know that I am done. That is completely factored. I strongly encourage you that when you see a negative lead coefficient, that you remove a GCF of negative 1 from those three terms. While this is factorable with the negative there, it is a little more complicated, and it would be much quicker if we remove that GCF. So I'm going to remove a GCF of negative 1, which means that I'm dividing each of these terms by negative 1. So basically all the signs are going to change. So we get 6x squared now minus 11x, and then we have minus 10. Unlike the previous two questions, we now have more options to pick from, because 6 has 6 and 1 and 2 and 3, and 10 has 10 and 1 and 2 and 5. So I have more factor pairs than I need to pick from when I'm deciding which pairs I need in order to get a negative 10 multiplication, but a negative 11 adding or subtracting. So if I look at these, so again, certain things don't make sense. That's going to give me 60, and that gives me 1 when I multiply them together. I can't get 11 with that. And if I flip it around and go 6 times 1 and 10 times 1, well, I can't use a 10 and a 6 to get 11 either. So those two definitely don't work together. But I can't eliminate any yet. So let's see. Let's see if we can eliminate 10 and 1. So if I do 10 times 2, that's 20, and 10 times 1 is 3. So 20 and 3. Can I get 11 with that? No, I can't. So that doesn't work. And I did 10 times 2. So if I do 10 times 3, well, that's even worse, because that's 30, and you're going to have 30 and 2, and can't get 11 with that. So we've eliminated 10 and 1 as an option. So let's check 2 and 3 and 2 and 5. So if I do 2 times 3, that gives me 6. If I do 2 times 5, that gives me 10. Can I get 11 by adding or subtracting those together? No, I can't. So that doesn't work. But that doesn't mean 2 and 3 doesn't work. Notice I did 2 times 5. What if I do 2 times 2, which gives me 4, and then 3 times 5, which gives me 15? Well, can I get 11 with that? Yes. In particular, by subtracting. So my goal is to get a negative 11. And so in order to get a negative 11, I need to have a negative on the 15 and a positive on the 4. So let's go ahead and put on our factor pairs. So I have 2x and 3x. So when you put in the first factor pair, it doesn't matter where it goes. I could have these two flip-flopped. But now that I've put in the 2x first and the 3x in the second binomial, then that does dictate where the 2 and the 5 need to go. So I multiplied 2 times 2. So 2 times 2 for my outer, and then 3 times 5 for my inner. And notice that gives me my 15x and my 4x that I desired. So now I need to worry about my signs. So we said that the 15 needs to be the negative and the 4 needs to be positive. So the only way I can multiply those two together and get negative is if this is negative. And so that would make the 2 over there and the second binomial have to be the positive. So if I check, I get negative 5 times positive 2, which does give me negative 10. If I multiply 2x squared times 3x squared, I do get 6x squared. And if I check my O and my I, I do get the negative 11x that I wanted. And so this is the factored form of that trinomial. Notice that I didn't get rid of that negative 1. It's still there. Just like when you remove any other GCF, it needs to come along for through the rest of the problem. Because whatever you write, it needs to be able to multiply together in order to give you the original problem. So you can't lose pieces of information. The next three questions are for you to try. So go ahead and pause the video. Try these two problems and the one on the next slide, and then resume the video in order to see the answers. And I'll give you a sneak peek of the other one. So go ahead and try them, and then resume the video to see the answers. So here are the answers to the first two. With S1, there weren't a lot of options to choose from, because the factors of 1 are just 1 and times 1. And the factors for 5 are just 1 times 5. So there really wasn't much flexibility. You just had to worry about the signs. And so you can see how I wrote it in. And then when I checked my O and my I, I got 1y and a 5y, and I knew that I needed to get 4y. And so in order for that to happen, the 1y had to be my negative. And so you can see I made my inner product be the negative y. For S2, there were more options to pick from. 3 and 1 was the only options for the first spots in each of the binomials, but then I had to figure out whether 6 and 1 or 2 or 3 was more appropriate. And I determined that 2 and 3 worked with 3 and 1 because 3 times 3 is 9, and 2 times 1 is 2, and I could combine those together to get the 7 that was in the original trinomial. Then I needed my signs to work, so I needed a positive 7x. And so in order for that to happen, the 9 needed to be positive and the 2 was the negative. And so you can see up in my answer where the 2x comes from. I made it so that the 2 was negative, so I could get the negative 2x, and the 9x is positive with that plus 3. For the third problem, notice that I removed a negative 1 GCF first. You didn't have to, but I particularly don't like trying to factor a quadratic when the lead coefficient is negative, and so I removed that GCF of negative 1 in order to make it easier to factor. However, you may have factored it without removing the GCF. Your answer will look similar, except in one of your binomials, the signs will be flipped. Not both, but just one. And so if you basically have the same answer without removing that negative one, and it's just maybe these are both negative, or in this one you have a minus 2k and plus 3, then you have an equivalent answer. So I removed the GCF of negative one, remembering to change my signs. I also rewrote it so that it was more in standard form, which is highest power to lowest power when you're writing a quadratic. There were quite a few options to pick from. Each one had two factor pairs to work with, and I determined that the way to set it up was to use the 2 and the 4 and the 3 and the 3. And so 2 times 3 gives me 6, 4 times 3 gives you 12, and in order to get the negative 6 that's in my version of the problem, since I removed the GCF of negative 1, I needed the 12 to be negative. And so notice in my O and my I then, I made the 12 be the negative and the 6 be positive. And that is the answer to that problem. So now I want to talk about factoring by grouping. So factoring by grouping is a situation that occurs when you have four terms, or maybe more, but the ones that we're going to look at are just four terms. Now, what I'm showing you right now is the second step of the process. So if you notice, I have a GCF between these two terms. And if you don't recognize the two terms, here's one term, here's another term. Remember, a term is something that's being added or subtracted to something else. And so if you look, they both have a factor of x plus y. So I can remove that as a GCF. I have a GCF of x plus y. And so I can remove that. I can factor it out, and if I divide each of these by x plus y, then I'm left with 3 plus z. And so I've now factored this further than it was before by removing that GCF. If I would FOIL this, then I would end up with what I originally started with, and actually something that looks more like the problems that you're going to do. So part of factoring by grouping is basically removing a GCF twice, where the first GCF, the one I haven't shown you yet, comes from just two terms instead of all the terms. So let's just look at one more. If I look at this, then you notice that they have a common factor of f minus g. So if I write f minus g and remove that, I'm undistributing, removing the GCF. Then I'm left with an e minus 4. And so now this is completely factored. So what do the original problems look like? Well, the original problems look like this. So if you look, none of the terms have a common GCF, but if I pair them, The first two terms, they have a GCF of A, and the second two terms have a GCF of C. So in the first two terms, if I remove a GCF of A, then I'm going to be left with 3 plus B. And for the second pair of terms, if I remove a GCF of C, then I'm left with 3 plus B. So if you look after this first step, I have something that looks like the last two problems that I did. So the first thing I did is I removed a GCF from the first pair, and then I removed a different GCF from the second pair of terms. Now I can remove the GCF of 3 plus b. So if I factor out the 3 plus b, what's left? Well, the a plus the c is left, a plus z. So this binomial multiplication here is the factored form of that polynomial that has four terms. So factoring by grouping is a way that works in some instances to factor larger polynomials that don't follow the same processes that we've looked at so far. If we would FOIL this problem back out, we would end up with the original problem that we had. In many instances, the terms will already be in order in which they should be paired. However, if you are trying to factor by grouping and it doesn't appear to work like this the first time, notice how we have 3 plus b and 3 plus b, then try rearranging the terms in order to make the factoring by grouping work. So here's another one. So if I look at the first two terms, I see I have a GCF of b. So if I remove a GCF of b, I'm going to get 3a minus 1. Now, for the second factor pair, remember my goal is basically to sort of have a number here, and then I'm going to have my parentheses. And what's in parentheses should match what's in these parentheses. So even though there's this minus 4 here, I don't want to remove a GCF of negative 4. I only want to remove a GCF of 4. And again, the reasoning for that is that I need to have a minus 1 left inside. If I divide negative 4 by 4, then that still leaves me with the minus 1. If I divide negative 4 by negative 4, then I'll have a plus 1, and it will no longer match my other set of parentheses. When I divide 12a by 4, I get 3a, and you can see now I now have 3a minus 1 and 3a minus 1. So now I can remove a GCF of 3a minus 1, and so we get 3a minus 1 as my GCF removed. What's left when I remove GCF from here? You're left with a b. When I remove the GCF from here, I'm left with a 4, and so I get b plus 4. And this is now the factored form of that polynomial. One thing I wanted to point out before we move on is that notice that when you divide b divided by b up here, you do end up with a 1. A common mistake that students make is that they won't write anything because they think the answer is 0 or because it's nothing. But it's not nothing, it's 1. And you need that 1 there as a placeholder so that if I would go backwards and I would say b times 3a and b times minus 1, that I would end up with this binomial right here. If you don't have this 1, then you can't get the negative b that you originally had. And so it's extremely important that when you divide a number by itself, that you write down 1 and not nothing. These two problems are for you to try. So go ahead and pause the video, practice factoring by grouping, and then resume the video to get the answer. So for S4, you can see right off the bat that I have a GCF between the two terms of R minus S, and so I remove that GCF. And then what was left was the 7 and the plus t, which is in my second set of parentheses. And so that is the factored form for this problem. For the next one, you'll notice that I have three terms, and all three of them have an a minus b. And so I removed the GCF of a minus b, leaving me with the a, the plus 4b, and the minus a. right here in the second parentheses. Combine like terms, and I ended up getting 4a. Now you could write your answer like this instead. That's perfectly fine as well because of the commutative property of multiplication. I also want to point out that this problem could have been done very quickly and very simply if you paid attention to your terms and that you had like terms here. So if you notice that these are the same, but they're opposite, so right away we could have added them together and got zero, and you can see that then we end up with the answer right there. This problem is for you to try, so go ahead and pause the video. Practice factoring this polynomial, going through the whole process of factoring by grouping, and then resume the video to see the answer. So here's our answer. In this one, you have to be particularly careful about something. Remember, our goal is that what's in the parentheses after the first step should be the same so that I can remove that as the GCF to get my final answer. So if you look at the pair of terms, when I removed x squared from the first two, I ended up with 3x minus 1. Now when I look over at the second two pair of terms, I can see real quick that I can divide them both by 3. But if I divide 3 by 3, I'm going to get a positive 1, not a negative 1 like I have in my other set of parentheses. So in order to make that be a negative 1, or a minus 1, I removed a GCF of negative 3. I divided both of these terms by negative 3 in order to get a positive 3x minus 1 in my second set of parentheses. Now that those matched, then I could remove the GCF of 3x minus 1, leaving me with the x squared minus 3. Before we move on, I just want to point out that this right here does not factor further, even though it sort of looks like a DOS. It's not a DOS because 3 is not a perfect squared. If the 3 had been, say, a 4, then I could have factored further into x plus 2, x minus 2 as DOS's factor. However, since 3 is not a perfect squared, I could not do that. So this problem is completely factored. So let's look at our application problem. So here it says find the width of a rectangle if its area is that polynomial, and they give me the length. So how do you find area? Well, area equals length times width. So that means that this area is a product of this length along with whatever the width looks like. So that means that my area, 3x squared plus 9xy plus 6y squared, needs to equal 3x plus 6y times whatever the width is going to be. Now, there are different ways that we could approach this. We could divide both sides by this and use long division and figure out what the width would be, but there's actually an easier way here. If I look, remember that when I do my L in FOIL, that this first term and this first term have to equal this. So what has to be in this spot so that when I multiply it by 3x, I get 3x squared? Well, the only thing that works is x. Then we'll do the same thing with the second term. 6y times what will give me 6y squared? Well, the only thing that works is y. And then now I need to check my O and my I. So I get 6xy, and I get 3xy, and I want it to be a positive 9xy. What do the signs need to be? Well, the 6 is already positive, we know that, and the 3 would have to be positive as well. So that means that this sign has to be positive also. So now I can say that the width equals x plus y. In this lesson, we learned how to factor trinomials where the lead coefficient was not 1, and we also learned how to factor by grouping. This completes the lesson. You are now ready to begin the homework.